Hello all. Good evening and thank you for joining the meeting. So we are starting and so we are glad to have Mr. Vijendra with us. And so today is the 8th episode of Sunday Samvad. Those who are for the first time joining Sunday Samvad, so Sunday Samvad is a vertical of MyTIS. And MIT is a students-led media platform by and for TISS students. And Sunday Samvad is an open platform where TISS alumni from diverse work areas join on Sunday evenings and morning to discuss about their experiences and journey of the professional path they have followed after passing out from TISS. And today we are glad to welcome Mr. Vijendra from 2013-15 batch. And I'll introduce Mr. Vijendra. So Mr. Vijendra is a tuning scholar from India, where he pursued Masters in Science in International Development, Poverty, Conflict and Reconstruction from the University of Manchester. Mr. Vijay is a passionate field practitioner with over 4 years of experience with Tata Steel Rural Development Society in the state of Jharkhand and Odisha, where he worked with children and youth. His journey from his native village Kadlabal in Karnataka to the interiors of Chhattisgarh and Jharkhand has given him an in-depth understanding of rural communities. Mr. Vijay currently leads a youth movement called Yuva Shakti in Karnataka, where the project is under an organization called Reap Benefit. I'm also pleased to say that he has a master's in social work from the same course that I am currently enrolled in, that is Community Organization and Development Practice from TISS Mumbai. And further, prior to this, he has also completed one more master's in financial economics from Gokhale Institute of Politics and Economics, Pune, where his passion to work for the developmental sector found his desired direction. Also, during our conversation, I also found that Mr. Vijay not only has work in only Tata Steel or you can say currently Reap Benefit, but also is associated with various organizations which work for political advocacy as well as health of mothers and children. And he's also done a great work, relief work during the corona pandemic lockdown. And I guess during the conversation you'll all hear about what a social worker can do or does simultaneously, not only just about his career or about a position or a designation, but also works on an individual level as well as an organization level. So welcome, Mr. Vijendra. We are glad to welcome you on this platform.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. So today's episode 8 is focused on community organization and youth engagement because of the work experience Mr. Vijay has. So our discussion today will have a kind of an interactive session between me and Mr. Vijendra. And the areas of discussion would be, first of all, we'll be discussing about what are the roles and functions Mr. Vijay has played at various organizations. Secondly, we'll be discussing the challenges and approaches a social worker can have or a developmental practitioner can have while working with youth. Third area of discussion would be the skills required and what are the future opportunities therein while we are working with youth or we are working with the community. The fourth area of discussion would be the TISS context, in that sense that what knowledge we gain in TISS and the values that we inbuilt in ourselves. How can we channelize those values and knowledge at the field level? And lastly, after knowing the TIS context, we'll move on to the question and answers, So I request participants to post their questions on the chat box. We'll be taking it after the initial session. So with your permission, sir, can we begin the discussion?
Yes, sure. I just wanted to know if there is anybody in the audience who is uncomfortable with Hindi, because I might switch to Hindi in between back and forth.
Yeah.
Unconscious.
No issues. If there is a, if you can, Hindi or English is fine with us, because anyways, if there is Hindi in your speaking, I'll bit summarize in brief. So there is no issue. Yeah.
Okay.
And participants can switch on their videos and keep themselves on mute so that Vijendra sir enjoy talking with, because he said that he likes a kind of interactive more rather than being a monotonous dialogue. So yeah. So shall we start, sir?
Yeah.
Yeah. So thank you. So first of all, sir, can you, in the next 5, 7, 8 minutes, can you discuss about the roles and functions of your professional journey, like the projects you have undertaken? You know, you are working with Tata Steel CSR. Also, you went after that to London, where you worked for, where you studied masters in poverty and conflicts. You know, so, and also now you are leading a project called Yuva Shakti. So can you discuss your trajectory of your professional journey? What were the roles and functions that you did?
Sure. Thanks, Dadich. I think I'm very happy to be here, firstly, and thanks for all of you to giving us your time. So my professional trajectory began with Tata Steel Rural Development Society, where I was placed on campus. But I think it was more in continuation of my fieldwork experience within TIS. While in the first year, I did my fieldwork in a special school in Santa Cruz. In the second year, when we had block placements in CODP, I wanted to go to Chhattisgarh and spent 2 block placements in Chhattisgarh, where I the first placement was with an organization called Jan Chetana Manch, where we did some grassroots advocacy. And the second time was for Chhattisgarh Social Audit Unit. So the only reason I joined Tata Steel Rural Development Society was because they were working in a tribal context area. And the presentation that the then chief CSR gave was appealing in terms of, he was assuring us that we will have all the kind of independence that we would seek to work within the organization. And being a critic from outside, some of us wanted to explore, can we actually make a change being within the organization? When we began my stint in June 2015, initially the 6 month was supposed to be a probation period, and we were called development trainees. So we didn't have any project specifically, but we were expected to spend some dedicated time in one of the most backward villages in Jharkhand. That was just maybe trying to give us a sense of how different Jharkhand and rural context of Jharkhand can be with respect to any other rural parts of the country. As soon as the 6 month stint got over, I was placed at a unit called Novamundi, which is a iron ore mining site. The reason was we were doing a micro planning exercise with Tata Trust, where we were planning, we were trying to get a sense of what do these 50 or 80 villages around us, how can we do micro level census in a way so that the panchayats or the departments at the block level, district level can plan their next 5 years budgets. This was a requirement from the then DC of the district. So because I had a statistics background and I was comfortable in working in the interiors of the area, I think I was chosen with another colleague of mine. So my first project as such was working with young children, young youth, young adults of the area, trying to go into areas where you don't have any kind of network. But we had a tablet with us where we had to feed in data. This went on for around 3 months. And the next decision that the organization took was that I was posted in Nova Mundi, but they didn't know which vertical they had to post me into. All other colleagues of mine came from disability studies and action or mental health or livelihood and social entrepreneurship. So community organization is a very, it's an umbrella term. It can be any community. So they were confused, I guess, where to post me. So they left me in Nova Mundi. They told me, you can start exploring your key interest area and continue your work. So what I did was I started small innovations in existing CSR projects. So that became my profile over a period of time, that I will be looking at small and minor innovations in existing CSR projects. When I say innovation, it may be the way in which we are working, just changing the way we are working right now to make it more community-centric, to listen to people more than telling them, we are development professionals, we want to give you a solution. Rather than that, can we co-plan with the communities? So during this entire term of three and a half years almost, I think I was engaged at a micro level in Nova Mundi, where I looked up the major youth program, which the CSR program was running, called Rishta. It was a adolescent reproductive sexual health program. We were engaging with more than, I think, 3,000 youth. Apart from that, I was also overlooking for a small period of time a project called Mansi, Maternal and Newborn Survival Initiative, where we were trying to decrease the maternal and newborn survival rate or mortality rate, increase the survival rate and reduce the mortality rate. During these interactions, I engaged with people at district level officers, block level officers, state governments. And Tata Steel has a national program called Samvad, where it's one of its kind tribal platform, where they invite communities from across the country and across the world to come and be part of a 5-day celebration, which goes beyond just being a celebration, where we can talk and discuss about how can tribal communities own their narrative. Whether be it in administration, be it in politics, in different fields, how can they have a representation and own their narrative? This, we don't speak, the communities are just given a platform and they will speak. So I was involved in planning of this national level program, as well as we co-developed an event called Tribal Leadership Program, where we thought that if we can get young youth who are inspirational, who are doing any kind of leadership activity, it can be somebody teaching 5 children at their home or somebody fighting an advocacy bill for the state government for Manrega. Getting these people across, where a Northeast tribal youth can interact with somebody from, say, Kerala, or a Ladakhi tribal youth can interact with somebody from, say, Gujarat. And how can these stories in themselves become a part of the narrative, and they can inspire each other. I used cinemas extensively. We used to do movie screenings in the villages. That was part of my innovation, where to have any kind of dialogue, a context is required, right? If you go with a Tata Sumo or a Scorpio into a village, nobody's going to entertain you. So we used to have evening screenings of movies which were made by tribal communities, documentary films. And then the later second half of the day, we used to discuss on what did we see from these movies and what did we understand? The next journey that I took was probably a scholars program. The organization nominated me to be part of a co-scholars program, which was happening in Panchgani in Maharashtra. This was an international program on conflict transformation and peace building, a 21-day rigorous curriculum. I was nominated because I was working in the Naxal belt, and maybe some of my approaches were centered around conflict transformation without my own understanding. So they wanted to give me an academic bent. When I went there, the organizers asked me to be a coordinator for their program in the next year. So I took up a small assignment with them. That's when my international engagement began. This was an organization called Initiatives of Change. When I left the TSRDS, it was mostly in terms of to get a career progression, as well as come back to my native state of Karnataka. But I didn't want to start working continually, so I took up a evening scholarship, which where I was funded, and I spent time in Manchester studying MSc International Development with focus on poverty, conflict, and reconstruction. The program also had an inherent fieldwork experience in Uganda, one of the reasons why I chose the program. While I was there, I was also working with the same international organization, IOFC, in Switzerland, where I helped them organize a conference on just governance and human security. These are dialogues where elite institutions like UN come and discuss peace building. So running that program was a unique experience. I also spent 6 months, 5 months in Scotland working with a farming community where they were hosting me with food and shelter, and I was volunteering for 5 months, 5 hours in a day. And I had the rest of the day for myself. When I came back to India in February 2020, I was confused. What do I do? I was engaging with a couple of international organizations on a voluntary basis. I'm on the board of directors of an organization called Vitamin Angels India, which supplies multi-nutrients in 30% of areas where government does not intervene across the world. They are setting up a Vitamin Angels India substitute. So they want to fundraise from India itself. So we are trying to devise a roadmap for them. What should be their priorities in the next 10 years? I'm also very recently on the board of director of an organization called Hindus for Human Rights, which tries to challenge the narrative of Hindutva through the narrative of Hinduism. Of course, going without said, not without acknowledging the flaws in the religion itself, but how can we, if the fact that there is no Hinduism narrative, which is there's no unilateral Hinduism narrative, has given space for Hindutva to claim that saffron is for themselves. So how we can challenge that with the diaspora? So even currently, when I'm working with Reap Benefit, the goal of the project is to work with 5,000 youth in Nelamangala, which comes in Bangalore rural district, for a period of 1 year, and try to build a movement where we are trying to activate constitutional values between the age group of 15 and 29. How are we going to do that? Through public problem solving. So that's what Reap Benefit does. Reap Benefit solves public problems through the youth. And they have tools and other resources at your belt where you can use their platforms, and any problem has a particular way of approach they use, which is discover, investigate, solve, and share. It can be a streetlight, it can be education funding, which is not coming for a school. What we do in rural Bangalore is just go one step ahead. If you solve, for example, a public toilet issue, how can we ensure that every community in the village has equal access to that toilet? So going deeper into the question of equality, justice, liberty, fraternity is what we are trying to do. I think I tried to sum up, but yeah, a lot of it has been lost in the time frame. But I think I'll be able to answer them as we go forward through various examples.
Yes, sir. I understand. And so just follow up question from what you told. What do you advise to, as you, we see that you have been working on various multiple, even voluntarily, or even, you know, just for your experiences when you're not being paid or you're not even designated, you know, at the same time, you are designated at other places too, you know, official on a payroll. So do you advise students to just, you know, put your feet wherever you can, or how does it? Sir, you are on mute. Sorry, sir.
I'm sorry. I think the key here is passion. If you are able to find out what your passion is, then I think no matter from what direction it is coming, you should be able to tap on and latch on to it. For me, all of these are various opportunities. If I had said no to being a program coordinator for a co-scholars program, for example, I don't think I would have had the mentorship that I got for H. Evening scholarship. Or if I had not done, I had not volunteered with Hindus for Human Rights when I was in London trying to do protests against CAA and stuff, I don't think I would have landed up with this current job. So I think they're not segmented fragments. They all go with, there's a cohesion amongst them. What matters is to identify and keep exploring where your passion as a social worker or a development practitioner exists. Just to say an example, I think a lot of activities happen in TIS. So, and there are open invitations. There can be a film screening, there can be a lecture. Like this was an optional seminar, right? So we choose to be a part of it because we feel we might want to learn something. So what matters in a professional role is when you are having multi-stakeholder engagements, trying to have one step forward, trying to make connections, having that networking skill. I know a lot of us feel that we don't have the kind of language or fluency where we might find difficult to speak to a new person, might be an introverted in nature. But in terms of profession, I think the more you share with people, the more people will come to know about you. And the more people know about you, they will guide you with different opportunities in life. No matter how much time you spend on the internet, you'll not be able to get that kind of an exposure that somebody who has dealt in with the field of 20 years experience can give you. So it's more about staying true to yourself, sticking to your passion and choosing your battles. I do say no to a lot of projects which I get offered because I literally don't have the bandwidth to spend my energy on them. But if there is something that connects to my heart, I definitely take it on without a second thought and then make space for it while I'm working on other things.
Yeah, yeah, I get that. So yeah, even if we can discuss the area where we're discussing skills and opportunities which specific to youth. But before that, one thing that we see that after you have done engaged with so much organizations, you know, on multiple micro, meso, as well as macro levels. The question here is that, or what are the challenges and how these challenges can be approached while we are working youth, specific to youth? What challenges did you face and how did you overcome those, and what were the approaches, organizational approaches as well as your individual approaches?
Right. I think a very important question because the moment we graduate from TIS and enter the professional world, the life will be full of challenges. What we have been developed as a culture over a period of 2 years is suddenly, it's like a bubble that has burst. But that is the real world. I think the first and foremost challenge that comes is to blend with the organization culture that you are entering into. It might be an internal culture. It might be the way they deal with stakeholders. It might be the way they deal with a funding partner. But every organization has a culture. An NGO works in a particular way and each NGO works in a particular way. Each corporate works in a particular way. I think it's very important to spend enough time in the beginning to try and understand, okay, what are the organization culture and values which are non-negotiable for the organization? And then align those with your personal values, which are non-negotiable to you. To give you an example, I knew that I was in a CSR organization, but I would never engage in R&R work, rehab and restructuring kind of work. I had told the organization very clearly that I'm completely against them in the principle. If you want me to get a FRA clearance, I will not be able to do that. But since I had come from a finance background, I knew that CSR was a big resource for me. So identifying these resources, identifying the opportunities, and while working with the community, what matters the most is striking a chord with the community. I felt a lot of challenges internally because I decided not to follow certain rules which Tata Steel follows. They have a rule where every officer has to wear a big leather shoe, which is called a safety shoe, because it's an extractive industry. If you're working inside a steel plant, if a hot metal comes and falls on your shoes, they want to save you. My point was that I'm going into the villages. The moment people see me with those shoes, they will identify with me as a Tata Steel employee and not as a community organization worker. So I will not lie to them. I will tell them I am from Tata Steel. But the way I tell them, do I introduce myself as, hi, I'm Tata Steel Rural Development Society executive. I come from TISS. I'm from Karnataka. I want to work with you. Or do I say, main Karnataka se hoon. I'm going to, I spent last 3 years working with communities here. Currently, I am engaged with Tata Steel Rural Development Society. So how you portray yourself in the ecosystem, how you identify what are the organization values which you want to align with and which you don't want to align with, more importantly. And also how you use communication as a strategy. Every project has their own outcome, their goal. There's a vision, a mission, and a goal, which is the outcome of the project, right? But you need to understand that there are three pillars. One is an input, an output, and the third aspect is an outcome. Input is in your hand. What are you giving to the community? It may be a training session. It may be a film screening. It might be a session you take in a school. It can be time you spend in the village trying to understand what the community needs. Here is where innovation can be done. No organization will stop you if you tell them, okay, you are following the particular approach A, and for some reason it's not working. Can I follow the particular approach B to come to the outcome? No organization will stop you for that. But the way you communicate, the timing of when you communicate, we can't change everything on day one. You'll have to spend enough time, 6 months, 7 months, and then say, where are the opportunities? Have you understood the project before you want to change something inside it? Have you understood the how community rapport had been built before you were there? There's also something called do not harm theory, which we all study, I believe, I'm not sure. You don't want to harm the community without meaning to, right? That's the worst thing you can do. If you don't change the status quo, it's fine. But if you have a situation where you end up in a worse situation than you were there before you entered the community, that's the worst thing that we can do to the community. So understanding these key integral concepts of how to use communication as a strategy, how do you use negotiation skills as a strategy to bring in small changes in the way the program is done. I don't think the sector needs anything drastically different from what is already happening. What they need are these small minute changes. If you spend one night in a village, you will get to know a lot of things about the village. But organization might have a rule that you are not supposed to spend night in the village. How do you rationalize with them and overcome that hurdle? That will have a long-term impact on how you understand the community, how accepting the community becomes of you. Also, important to not make yourself an integral part of the community. You know, at some point of time in your back that this is a career opportunity, I'm going to go out of here. So I made it a point in every meeting of mine to tell them that I'm not going to be here always. There is a dependency syndrome which comes with people working with the community over a period of time. So our focus should always be to create a system of self-dependence and a sustainable system where Vijay is there or not, systems should function. So it is these very key minute details, which I think people usually miss, which I saw in my own batch also. But if you address these, I think you will be able to have a meaningful time with any organization, and the organization will also find value in you as a person. So just to reiterate, I think organization values, culture, how do you align yourself with the organization? There has to be some kind of alignment. There can be disalignment in a few aspects, but if there is no alignment, then the organization is not the right way for you. There's no point in continuing. So you need to understand where do we align and where do we not align. Second is how to bring in small, minute innovations or changes in approaches in terms of how the program is being run, mainly at the input level. And third is how do we become a part of the community without creating a dependency syndrome.
Yeah, thank you. These inputs are very experiential, and this cannot be done without a field experience. But can you, sir, one or in some brief, in a minute, you can see what there are different approaches in the context of youth. When we talk about youth, how community engagement differentiates itself when we are engaging with youth?
Right. I think what matters is the age group you are dealing with. Usually I used to deal with students from age standard and above, and also college students or dropout students. One significant change that always happens is if you go to a community, the community is usually receptive of you. They involve you within them. Somebody in the community will try to take you around the village, try to show where the village temple is and where the school is. Somebody will do that. Youth, because they are in an adolescent stage, usually are non-receptive of you. So you will have to strike a chord with them. That is very important, even if you are able to strike conversation on something the youth would want to speak about. Do they watch cricket? Do they watch IPL, or do they watch the film? Do they know that Priyanka Chopra has a base from Jamshedpur? It can be anything. Trying to not deep dive directly into the work you want to do, if you are able to get the youth on your side, the entire community around the village will be behind your backs. And it's very difficult to do that. So I think initially, if you are interacting with any youth, try to remember how you yourself were when you were in their age. You would not be very different. Like I was in my 24, 25 when I interacted with 18-year-olds. But I tried to not prescribe anything, or if I wanted to understand what is their water-related issue, I would allow the youth to speak even for 2-3 hours sometimes. They might be repeating themselves. But it's very important to make sure that you are on the right side of the youth. Because if they don't want to participate, then nothing you make will make them participate in any of your sessions. But if you strike the chord with them, I know it sounds very philosophical, but I think it's extremely important to understand, have some activities designed where you are able to make it participative. You are able to understand the youth more. What are the inputs that you can get about the youth? Are they interested in career counseling? Are they interested to understand how they can make money for a living? Are they interested in farming issues? Once you know that, you can also segregate those youth groups based on those interest areas. So I think it's very important to be patient in this. It can take sometime weeks, sometime months, sometimes even 3-4 months to be on the right side of the youth group, because they all spend 24 hours together. You have come from outside. You are trying to interact with them because of some project you are doing, and you are telling them, okay, we want to spend 2-3 hours in a week with you. They need to have an incentive to do that. It cannot be just learning. So do you have games designed for them? Do you play cricket for half an hour in that? Do you play hockey? How do you interact with youth in which they don't feel it's an ask to come and sit in your sessions? That becomes the most fundamental challenge. Once that is broken through, I think it's very easy to work with any youth.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for that relevant insight. Moving on towards the advice part of our session, what do you think are, so there are two parts of this area, like first is the skills and second is the approach. Second is the opportunities. So what do you think are the skills that TISS students can build more so before they pass out? Okay, before they sit for their placements, or even while they pass out, then there is some months in between. So what are the skills that they should build up? And secondly, what are the opportunities in the coming period when someone wants to work with youth? What are the opportunities or the projects that are more receptible by the youth as well as by the organizations? Yeah, thank you, sir.
Right. So in terms of skills, I think it's very difficult in this current period when there is no field work happening to develop certain key skills, but that doesn't put you in any kind of backstep. But something that this naturally does to you is build in an empathy within you. To continue that empathy is going to be difficult. So please ensure that wherever you go, do not let go of that emotional or empathy quotient that you have for the community. That will make your heart beat for the right cause. But in terms of more specific skills, I think documentation is something very essential. Even if it is, if you're using a computer and maintaining folders for different projects, maintaining Word document for any particular appraisal that you have, every project has a timeline and every project is divided into subgroups. It's very important to have those key documents and documentation in place. If you're going to a village, ensure that you have somebody with you to take photographs, to take minutes of the meeting, to have a structured approach to what you are doing. Otherwise, it'll end up that you are going to the village, talking to people, coming back. The same thing will happen in the next week. You might do repetition about what you spoke in the last week, but documentation is something that the organizations expect also. Since we are coming out of a professional course and a branded institute, So please work on documentation skills. When I say documentation, it does not mean good English. It just means you know where certain things are about your project. And you have a way of disseminating that to your team members also. Someday you might choose, I don't want to continue anymore. I want to move forward. So is there a system in place where you are transitioning that entire documentation to somebody else, where once they go through the document, they're able to understand, okay, this is what is supposed to be done. And this documentation includes all kind of MS Office. It includes PowerPoint presentations. It includes MS Excel. It includes Word. It even includes how you are able to communicate certain stories that you have experienced in the field. Even maintaining a personal diary really helps while you're on the field. Apart from this, I think a very key important aspect is to stay relevant in the sector, which means you need to know what is the National Skill Development Ministry say about youth. What is the definition of youth by the Indian government? What is the definition of youth in the state governments you're working in? Current affairs is something which is extremely important. I think every organization would appreciate that. So make sure that you dedicate some amount of your time during your pre-placement preparation phase to current affairs. You know that what UN is telling about youth, what are the current challenges youth are facing in COVID times. And this goes up across sectors. It can be for any community. But it's very important to understand these nitty-gritties, because otherwise you will be considered as irrelevant. In terms of opportunities, I think locally and globally, youth are going to be a focus post-COVID, mainly because there is going to be a lot of job losses and upskilling required. So in terms of Indian context, I think the Ministry of Skill Development keeps up coming up with a lot of opportunities for usually it's for 2-3 year old experienced people, but no harm in keeping a look on those kind of opportunities and trying to make use of them. I believe there's going to be a lot of funding that's going to come in across the globe, mainly in the third world, so-called third world countries, for youth development. Youth have been the center of COVID also. Most of the COVID warriors, which the government is deploying within the organization, are the youth. They are one of the least affected age groups. And they would also be very essential to revive the economy. So how do you, what are the gaps in the industry where these skill sets provided to the youth can translate into materialized jobs? And how do you do this in a way in which the youth do not feel that their needs are not met? Skill Development Ministry has a lot of different verticals. So how do you advocate for some vertical in a particular state? Also keep an eye open on a lot of online portals. I'm sure you'll be aware of a lot of them, but there are small apps called Youth Opportunities, which keeps giving you updates on different kind of programs and fundings available for youth-specific programs. You can be part of LinkedIn groups. You can be part of Facebook groups. If you're somebody who wants to do a startup, or if you're not somebody, if you don't want to do startups, it helps to be part of groups like Push Start on Facebook, where youngsters are discussing ideas of startups. I got a lot of ideas from there, even though I never wanted to have a startup of my own, but being part of a few conversations will lead you to multiple opportunities. There's something called as network capital. So be aware of these open source platforms. Some of them are paid, some of them are unpaid, but these go a long way in establishing that you end up in the right job which you really want to do. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you so much, sir, for that. These topics are very relevant to the topic we are discussing about community organization and youth. The next area of discussion comes out from the thing that when we are studying in TRSS, we come across various subjects, okay, from social action to urbanization to rural development to social legal things to various other subjects. But for example, if I want to work with youth, okay, there is only some specific knowledge that is applicable for my practice in the future or for my career. It's not everything maybe. So the area is that, or the question is that, what are the knowledge that you acquired in TISS that you still think, beyond obviously you said about the empathy thing and the social and the emotional quotient, beyond that, what is that domain specific knowledge or TISS specific knowledge that you think is still relevant for your career and we should all focus on those kind of knowledge?
I think the founding value that this has in terms of, I think even the tagline, learn, unlearn and relearn, I think it's very, very significant. I think very few universities have that kind of library which TISS has and the access to knowledge systems that TISS has. One important factor for me, again, it might not be relevant to this particular batch, but was definitely fieldwork. The fieldwork opportunities gave me a space to really find if am I meant for this sector. You know, we might be very passionate, but once you go into the field, you might realize I don't enjoy staying in the rural area because I don't have the things which I grew up with. This might not be the right calling for me. And it's important to know that also. But I think the experience that you have in terms of it may be small case study assignments that you have, try to not look at them as assignments. Try to look at them as your possible job opportunities. If you want to analyze a health scheme in Karnataka, or one of the courses might ask you to write a small project for a particular organization, try to take it to heart. And the more time you spend on them, the easier it becomes for you to work once you go, because some of these courses are very, very job specific, especially when it comes to analysis part. You are not asked to analyze a particular news article, but you're asked to analyze government schemes and projects. And it takes a different kind of skill set to do that. So if you don't take the assignments and the work that you are asked to do inside this as part of the structure, it's very unlikely that you would continue to take the work seriously outside this as well. So I don't think there's anything else out of the blue that will help you, but just doing these basics right, staying in touch with your dissertation or something which I really enjoyed. I also had an episode of depression during my dissertation. So it had two sides to it, but staying in touch with your fieldwork supervisor, staying in touch with people who speak about practical knowledge. I know that every faculty in this do not speak about practice. Most of them speak about theories. Theories are important, but there are very few who are engaged with real life work practice. Staying in touch with them, taking their subjects to your heart and doing these assignments, not just for the sake of assignment or marks, but doing them because you want to learn something. That attitude to learn is what will take you a long way forward. And that is something that I gained personally from this a lot than from other places.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So obviously the attitude, as you pointed out, matters a lot. And so, you know, continuing this part of the knowledge, but at the same point, Vijay Bhaiya, that there are certain values that we only discover in TISS. And at some point of time, after we quit TISS or even after we go to our homes, those values seem vulnerable. You know, and not only just personal values, but even societal values, you know. And when we move on to an organization, specifically organizations like corporate CSR, you know, or NPOs, or now there are startups. So these values, organizational values, individual values, and societal values, there are various conflicts that happen. And sometimes I have heard from various alumni that these students bahut jaldi chhod dete hain naukri. Aur uske do hi karan hai, ya to fir unhe kaam nahi aaya, या तो फिर उन्हें ऑर्गेनाइजेशन समझ नहीं आया. तो आई थिंक कैन यू टॉक थिंग्स दिस थिंग अबाउट वैल्यूज एंड हाउ कैन वी नेगोशिएट पर्सनल ऑर्गेनाइजेशन एंड सोसाइटल वैल्यूज टुगेदर एज वेल एज प्रोग्रेस ऑन आवर करियर्स, नॉट जस्ट क्विट.
राइट, राइट. I think it's a major factor. There is overwhelming feeling in the organization, specifically in the last, I think, decade, that places like TISS and JNU, inside values inside you, which are not able to take it forward, or they're in conflict with the organizational values. Something that I remember from my TISS days also is the foundational courses that we used to have. And Ritambara Hebbar was the professor, and she told that we had this session on family structures and patriarchy and caste system, and she told that it's going to be very difficult for you when you go to your homes in the holidays. And it turned out to be absolutely true. I come from an upper caste family, and what is important, I felt, is that there is a difference in confronting and trying to engage in a dialogue. If I am expecting that what I learned in TISS over a period of 2 years is something that my parents will understand as soon as I speak to them about it, be it about caste, be it about privilege, it's not going to be like that. It's important to step in the other person's shoe and try to see where they are and where did they ingrain their value systems from. At the same time, if you learn something which is very valuable, like I got my sense of privilege for the first time when I was inside TISS. And I hold that very dear to me. I make it a point to learn about all of my privileges and accept them and acknowledge them. At the same time, try to keep them aside when I'm working. When I'm working, I'm an individual. So it's important to understand what are those values which you want to stick to. You might learn 20 different things, but those one or two things would mean the most to you. How do you plan to engage with that is a different question. But I think when it comes to organizations, where students fall short is in the due diligence. I think we don't try to find out enough about the organization. Can we try to find some alumni who's working in the organization? Can we engage to know what is the organization like? You get to know very few things when an organization comes for a presentation or a pre-placement talk, right? They only want to tell you what they want to tell you. So how do you research and try to understand what is it that you are getting into? If your expectation is right, then you won't be disappointed. Something which I dealt with when I was coming with TISS also, because I had a master's before, maybe I did more due diligence than other of my peers to try, and I knew what I was expecting from TISS, which is not true for a lot of them, and they were disappointed. When I was going into a CSR, I knew that TSRDS, Tata Steel Rural Development Society, is not Tata Steel. It's a society, and there will be differences in which you are treated in terms of salary, in terms of expectation, everything. And also to be able to understand what Jharkhand, living in Jharkhand, is going to be like. It's very important to do that due diligence and know that, get your expectations right. If you are expecting 20 and you end up with a package of say 30, you'd be very happy, right? I'm just giving you random numbers. But if you are signing up for a job which you're not done due diligence, that is the most likely reason that more than the clash of values, I think if you're able to do due diligence, you will be able to adapt to those values without letting go of your own values. There's always a thin walk between them, and it's possible to do that. My first 6 months, I really struggled to manage that. I was like, I'm in a corporate. What do I do? I don't. The way we are spoken to, the way we are shown around, it's almost so... non-utopian world. And it is very difficult to continue. But what I and a colleague of mine decided was that, okay, we are here now. We have decided that we're going to spend a couple of years here. Let us start working. We came up with some new ideas, try to share them with the management, and we got an okay with it. So it's important to not get stuck with those. Even if you find something which doesn't align, that is a challenge, right? When you are in your 20s and 30s, that is the time when we can actually handle conflicts. It's more difficult to handle these conflicts or values at a family level. When it comes to something like caste or religion or even income inequalities, having a talk about these things in family is much, much more difficult. But in organization level, if you are able to do your due diligence, understand what the organization is working. If it is a CSR, their job is not development. Their job is to get social license for their operations. This has to be clear. At the same time, they have funds. They want to utilize the funds. So your opportunity is to make the best use of the funds in a way which you want to do and show all the outcomes to the organization. So if you are expecting that CSR hai, so you will be able to do some groundbreaking work. It might be possible, but that might not be the right approach initially. You might get a better salary than what you are getting at an NGO, but CSR has its defined roles and it's very important to understand those things. So do as much due diligence as possible and try to speak to as many people as possible. And I know there are rules where you will not be able to sit for more than one placement. Once you get through, you'll not be allowed to sit for others, which is fair. So try and pick and choose what are the kind of organization you want to sit for. I'll tell you something. Money can be made over a period of time. It's a myth that social sector does not have good money. I think you have to build value for yourself. So in your job, right after this, don't seek for money. Seek for an organization which will help you shape your future, where you have a good mentor in the organization who's going to help you to understand the basics of the sector. And I'm not telling work for free, but yeah, don't look for the highest package. Look for something which you would want to be engaging for the next couple of years or the next 3 years. And then you can carve a way out. If you create value for yourself, organizations will come to you. It's not a big sector. It's a very, very small sector. People know everybody in the sector. So if you are somebody who is good at something, the word will spread out. People will approach you. But you'll have to build that skill. If I ask some of you, what is that one particular thing which is unique to each of you? We would take some time to think about it. So when preparing for an interview also, try to be authentic. Try to look at if you are somebody who can work well with children because you have had kids at home or for whatever reason. How do you make use of your strengths? And how can we work on our weaknesses? Do a SWOT analysis for yourself. What is your biggest strength? What is your biggest weakness? And it's okay to accept weakness. It's okay to feel vulnerable when you're having such value-based conversations with your parents. What matters is, do you have the skills to deal with that vulnerability? It's okay to cry as a boy, but are you willing to cry in front of your parents? It's more, I think, an inner journey rather than having hands-on skills. The value system, how you deal with it at an organization level and even at a family level or a social level is more an internal journey. You'll have to deep dive within yourself, try to ask the right questions. Why did I choose TISS in the first place? What was my best moment in TISS? What was the time when I felt I shouldn't have come here? What was the time when I felt, you will make some lifelong friends in TISS. I'm still in touch with most of my friends in TISS. So how do you really value these things? Or do you get so busy with placements and the job outside that you're not able to build those relationships while you are in TISS? So I think the next couple of months when you're preparing for placements is going to be very, very important to do that deep dive exercise. To look at who really is Atul or Rahul or Vaishali or Upendra or Afreen. Who is that person? Who are you as a person? What is it that you really want to do in life? If you really enjoy doing something, it's not work. You don't feel that as a job. At the same time, I used to tell my bosses always that main naukri nahi karne aaya hu, main kaam karne aaya hu. So very mindful, naukri, the word comes from naukar, the slave, the mentality of slaves. So if you have an idea, you need to be in an environment where it is appreciated. So if somebody is discouraging you just because you are a newcomer, I will not sustain in that kind of an environment. But knowing that is important. I think you will have to go through an inner journey in the next couple of months and try to find answers about what are those things that you want to really fight for. You can't fight for everything. You have to choose your battles.
True. So yeah, that I think participants would have got a very unique as well as an inner perspective of what they can do while choosing their career. So I think what we had planned is discussed, I guess, about the structure. And there are some very important questions that I see in the chat box. Sir, can we continue to those questions?
Absolutely.
Yeah. So we'll end in next 10 minutes. So maybe we'll not be able to take all questions, but some of it. So the first question, even which I personally wanted to ask and which Atul is asking, and even I'll add to that question, that the question is, how did you move on to selecting the tuning scholarship and moving to London? In that context also, you know, my sub question is, there is a perspective, and specifically in our sector, that bahar padke aaya to bahut kuch kar liya hai, you know, but somewhere it is also not true that only studying out will raise your career progression. So you know, firstly, can you elaborate, how did you aspire or how did you map out your journey, and then what is the, in brief, that what is the importance of going for higher studies and how should people approach that thing? Yeah,
right. So I think one, when I went out, it was very clear that I never wanted to settle abroad. Something that people kept asking me is, why did you come back to India after studying outside? The point of going outside was just to get an international experience, to see how education systems function outside India, to see how different are teaching methodologies there and what kind of exposure can you get. So I was speaking to a lot of people when I was, I knew that I'm going to leave my job. I had committed morally committed for 2 years, but I ended up staying for 3.5 years because I was happy with it. But I was very conscious that I don't become obsolete. You know, you have your value when you are new in the organization. 1 year down the line, 2 years down the line, people might have newer opportunities or newer people in the organization. You might lose your existence. And it's important to choose that exit time from an organization very, very carefully. When I was deciding to move out, I knew I'm going to come back to Karnataka. I didn't know what I want to work or which area I want to work in. And my colleagues and my mentors who were guiding me told me that one thing that is missing in your CV right now is international experience. So it was more of a break from career, also a space for me to revisit or deep dive into myself, try to see what do I want to do once I go back to India. At the same time, if I'm getting a scholarship, then it does add value to your resume also. So when I went, I definitely knew I'm going to come back to India. It was just a career upskilling choice and nothing more than that. I will also say that going outside studying is not a big deal. There is this, I think it's a colonization effect that we have. Bahar jaake aaye to bahut bada top maar liya, aisa kuch bhi nahi hai. But I do believe that going outside India will has its own learning experience for you. At a personal level, I had never imagined cooking for myself. There were options of going for a hostel, but I didn't want to. I wanted to learn how to cook. So these were the things I was more interested in. I wanted to travel. I wanted to get a break from the 7 years I had spent, 4 years in 2 masters and 3.5 years in work. I wanted time for myself. At the same time, I didn't want to sit doing nothing. So it was a strategic choice of how to meaningfully engage my time and also add a skill to my resume. But going outside definitely helps you negotiate your salary in terms of, people do consider that you have added some value. So that is definitely there. But again, it depends on what scholarship you go on, how is the perception of that outside. Specifically in the UK, it was a 1 year master's. So, and the master's is not valid in India. UK master's are not considered as master's in India. So you need to be aware of these things as well. But I think what matters is that there are different ways of accelerating your career. One is shifting very often, but I don't think that's a very progressive way of doing it, because you will be asked this question every time in the interview, itna jaldi kyun shift kiya? So I spent considerable time in one organization. I did multiple projects within the organization, also did volunteer work outside the organization. But when I wanted to make a move, I wanted to be sure that I don't want to apply on a job portal. I will wait till somebody comes and feels that I'm valuable enough to contribute to their organization. So I didn't search for this job. People approach me. But having that confidence in a realistic way is something, calculation that each of us has to work on. But I definitely think that once you are 4 years, 5 years into the sector, it definitely makes sense to take a break, go into the academic world, try to look what are the new things academicians talking about. Because when I sat in Manchester, the one difference that I had, which was not there before, was I was able to relate to every theory with my own field experience, which was not there in TISS. At least there was a fieldwork experience, but it's very limited. But when I was studying in Manchester, everything that we spoke about, I had a context in my mind. Okay, this is what I did in Jharkhand. This could have been done in this particular way. Or this is a particular theoretical framework which I could have used to analyze my work in while working with youth. So it's a question of why you want to take a decision, whether you want to settle abroad, whether you want to upskill yourself, whether you want to return to India. It is also, in a way, an upward funnel for me. From financial economics, I went on to social work, which was more of development sphere, and then I went on to international development. So I was doing bottom to up approach rather than the other way around. We usually do science, then we specialize physics, chemistry, whatever, and then we get into masters. My life journey has been the opposite of it. So it was a very conscious decision about the subject which I wanted to study, about the place I wanted to study, and I spent enough time preparing for it. 6 to 7 months went in writing an application, but I could write that application because I had done some meaningful work before that. So stay true to yourself, give your best in the job that you do. That will add on to your application, whether you want to apply for a new job or you want to apply for higher studies.
Yes, yes, absolutely. So I think people Atul also got an idea about how we can approach higher studies specifically in abroad. So due to lack of time, there is only one more question that I think can be taken, or also if time permits after that, we can take one more. But the thing is that how can we, how is the current batch? So like the TISS 2020 batch has just entered, and surprisingly, they have their fieldworks on Zoom. So it's very depressing for them, maybe, or like, you know. So how can they fill this gap of fieldwork and the Zoom calls?
I think it's going to be tough. But what I suggest is if your financials permit you to, then do some voluntary work after your degree also, when life gets a little easier with COVID, maybe sometime in the next year. Spend 3-4 months working with an organization, even if it's for voluntarily, or try to reconnect with the field work, because nothing can substitute the field work. At the same time, I don't know what happens in the Zoom calls, but it might help to understand if there's an organization called Jan Chetana Manch you are trying to work with, to get all the documents that they have, try to understand how this organization began. Every organization has a journey, right? While you are in the field, you'll be working on a particular project or with the community. While you are working from a distant lens, you are zooming out and trying to see there is an organization in a particular geography with a particular community. How did it begin? Why did it begin? What is the relevance today? Trying to understand that knowledge about the organization will give you a lot of advantage when you are trying to assess other organizations during your placements or even going ahead in your career. People usually miss this part where it's important to understand why Narmada Bachao Andolan started in the first place, where it started, or how has it managed to sustain itself. People consider it to be a failure. I don't, because a lot of children are getting educated through NBA. A lot of youth movements have begun as a spiraling out of Narmada Bachao Andolan. And it is still considered to be one of the most community organized में सबसे बड़ा चीज माना जाता है अगर लोग आपको इकट्ठा करते हैं तो आज भी अगर इतने लोग नर्मदा ताय के पीछे आने के लिए राजी है तो कुछ तो उन्होंने सही किया होगा. So the most that I can think of working with your existing fieldwork is trying to understand the journey of the organization. वो कुछ टास्क देंगे आपको, वो करिएगा, but उसके अलावा try to find out what else can you know about the organization? How long has the organization been? what do the other people in the organization think about it? What do the, I don't know if it is possible to interact with community, but a few youngsters in the community might have an opinion about the organization. So these things will help you to understand what not to do going ahead. Learning from the mistakes that your fieldwork organization had done will help you to try to not replicate those mistakes. It's okay to commit mistakes, but I think it's important to keep doing new mistakes and learning from them.
Yeah, I think that that is a very kind of a unique perspective about, you know, learning from the organizations what they did wrong, you know, so that, you know, we can learn. Yeah. Can we take one more last question?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So yeah. So the question which Atul asked, and even I again relate to it, that this you know, you have been associating or networking with multiple people, multiple organizations simultaneously. So how did you build, or how can we network? What are the ways we can network beyond the online thing? There is LinkedIn and all that is there, but you know, this networking is a very you know, niche thing that everyone doesn't have in them, but how can we build that?
I think it's as simple as trying to making new friends. When we first entered TIS, all of us are new to each other. Even I didn't realize how it happened, but I think every organization will send you to some training programs, will send you to, every HR has a policy of trying to engage their employees in a meaningful way. They will try to send you to workshops. They'll try to send you to seminars, career forums. So it's important to exchange ideas there. It's important to take the initiative and talking to people there. If there is one very important person in the audience, everybody will go to them. But try to look at somebody whom everybody is not going and speaking to. Somebody will be in the room who is sitting on their own, and they might have a lot of knowledge to share. So you have to be very open as a person to spend enough. It can happen over a cup of coffee. It can happen over a period of a week. But it's important to understand that if you really know who you are and what you want to do in life, then sharing that with somebody else will build your network. Just to give you an example, if you're attending a seminar, there might be somebody else who also wants to work with the United Nations going forward. But unless you take the initiative and speak to them, you might never come to know that both of you had similar passions. So in this sector, since we are working with people, I think what matters is, even if you are inherently a very closed person who doesn't love to talk to people much, but it's important to overcome that over a period of time. It doesn't happen overnight, but be okay to speak to people, tell people where you are from, where does your family come from, how has your professional life been. Koi seminar mein jo coffee break hota hai na, that is, people use that to network. But don't have this in your mind ki main kuch paane ke liye network kar raha hun. Try to know that other person. Each of us is a library. There is a concept called as human library. Each of us is a library. So how well do we know each other? What can we learn from each other? These are the kind of questions which will help you to network. I mean, Facebook, LinkedIn are there, but I don't think they go that long a way as a one-to-one interaction will have. But like I said, you will be able to do that only when you know the deeper question for yourself in terms of what you want to achieve out of this degree, or what kind of a job do you think you are best equipped for. Ye jab pata hota hai, ya fir 10 saal baad ab apne aap ko kahan dekhte hain, ye agar pata hota hai, so you can easily talk about it to somebody. It's important to overcome those inhibitions. Are log kya sochenge, kya baat karun, kaise baat karun? It's very easy, I think. If you open up as a person, if you do the first, if you take the first step, then the other person will also take a couple of steps. And you might talk to 10 different people. Out of them, not everybody will be wanting to have a longer engagement. But usme se agar 20-25 logon mein se ek banda bandi mil gaya aapko, who can be, you think might help you, you might then ask them ki, I'm planning to shift my career, how do you think you can assist me. Getting in touch with your alumni, I think a lot of them, something that I have been helping people with is chevening applications from the last 3-4 years. Even in TIS, people used to message me on Facebook asking, how do you navigate through the TIS interview? क्या पूछते हैं, कितना पैसा मिलता है? तो मैं बोलता, अगर पैसे के लिए टेस्ट आ रहे हो तो गलत जगह है. इसका मतलब ये नहीं कि टेस्ट में पैसा नहीं बना सकते हैं. बना सकते हैं, बट दैट शुड नॉट बी योर प्राइमरी मोटिव. देन गेटिंग एन एमबीए और एचआर प्रोग्राम आल्सो माइट हेल्प यू, बट नोइंग दैट व्हाई यू आर एंटरिंग अ प्लेस, इफ यू आर गोइंग फॉर अ वर्कशॉप, व्हाई आर यू एंटरिंग इन द वर्कशॉप, इफ यू आर सिटिंग इन अ सेशन टुडे, नोइंग व्हाई यू आर सिटिंग हियर, these things will make it easier for you to take the first step. But it is difficult. It is difficult for most of us because we are taught in our schools not to talk, not to ask questions. So it's difficult for us to break that ice and start engaging with a new person. But can we have that confidence in ourselves and say, I'm trying to overcome this. Let me try and speak to people. If you have a, I never had a visiting card, but if you can exchange phone numbers, if you can know what has been the trajectory of that particular person, how did they end up in that workshop? How did they end up in the training program? What is the one learning they can give you from their life? They might be from your same city, from same village you are from, you never know. So talking to people is definitely something that you have to build over a period of time. If you're consciously aware about it, it will happen. Not the easiest thing to do.
Yeah. So I absolutely about the things you said. And at the end, it also in this our specific sector, it goes more to the inner side of our inner journey rather than, exploring the outer sides. So I think we are approaching the conclusion of the session, and our participants have also got, I hope, various insights from, your experiential journey at multiple levels. So we'll be uploading this video on our YouTube channel, that is MyTIS, and I'm very glad and honored, Vijendra Bhaiya, that you gave us your time and patiently tried to answer everything that came to us, and I hope that we continue our connect. There is one question more, that if participants want to connect to you, they can obviously connect through your LinkedIn. But if they ask for your email ID, can we share your email ID? Yeah.
Yes, definitely. So, I'm very open to sharing my email ID. In fact, if there are a few questions that are unanswered, you can email me the questions. I'll be happy to answer them. And my only request is, if you are emailing, just because of the lack of time that I usually have, think for a couple of days what you want to know from me. I'm willing to share everything. But agar aap mujhe email likh rahe, toh aap be confident of two things that you really want to know about. That would make things a lot of easier, because most of things like finding job or knowing when CSR recruitments happen, these things are available on Google. I would like to spend energy on more insightful experience of my own. So just have the email ID, definitely get in touch with me. I will be happy to guide you all. But yeah, just make sure that if you're sending an email, that is definitely the one thing that you want to know.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So yes. So, as I think, I also thank the participants of being patient and, listening to us. I know Sunday Samvad gets, mostly, a talk between two person, but, we need to maintain this kind of structure, because otherwise, it gets very haywire. But again, I thank you so much, Vijendra sir, for sharing your experience, and it has been a very insightful as well as an intriguing sharing of discussion and experiences. So I think we can conclude the session, and sir, we'll be in connect, we'll be in touch, and you can any day share any internship or job opportunities you come across to me, so that I can share across our platform and students can learn through it.
Definitely.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for your presence.
All the best. All the best, everyone.
Thank you all. Take care.